Humanistic therapies come along with the development of humanistic psychology, the third force in psychology, as it were, with Abraham Maslow, and we saw Carl Rogers and a number of other people. A lineage which has led us now to a thing called positive psychology, emphasizing the good in people and what goes right with people, what people have the capabilities of doing, their full potential to be tapped. So trying to figure out how we can emphasize our self-healing capacities, we have now a client-centered model that comes along. Because in the behaviorist model, which we'll talk about in a minute, you come and seek out the therapists, and they will analyze the behaviors, and they will analyze the contingencies, and they will tell you what you need to do to manipulate the contingencies to change the behavior. It's a very top-down system with that kind of deterministic idea behind it, that what you are at any given day is the sum total of all your learning experiences, all your reinforcements, all of your punishments, et cetera, of which you're no longer aware, but are going to be in probability zones to be more or less probable to do any given thing. And to change those probabilities, you have to actually alter the environment or the structure of contingencies. And so it's this top down, you go see the doctor, they diagnose it, they tell you what to do. If you do it, you should have pretty good behavior change results, if that's what you're after. With the psychodynamic concepts, your issue started when you were really, really young, and they became more or less ingrained in who you are. So you don't have a whole lot of hope for change, but also you're looking at a model that's deterministic. What happened to you then affects who you are now in a way that's very hard to go back and understand how it affects you, much less change it. But with the humanistic therapies coming along, they said, let's move it from the top-down model to the bottom-up model. The person coming to me, I'm going to now assume has some ability to take care of their own issues, but might lack the guidance needed to activate their self-healing capacities. Knowing what we know from some research, what we would do is just help clients train themselves to arm themselves to be better prepared to help themselves with their own lives. And that's a very optimistic model, not so deterministic. Client-centered therapy is a result of that process. You remember we talked about Mr. Rogers way back? Well, Dr. Rogers is who we're talking about, Carl Rogers. He started this off, and he did a program of research that supported his conclusions. And so, whereas psychodynamic therapy arose out of theory, and predominantly, originally, Freud's theory, modified by many, many, many other psychologists and theorists, Carl Rogers started off with some premises that he then tested in the actual research paradigm of having therapy itself studied, looking at the processes of therapy, looking at the processes of therapists' interactions with clients to see what worked and what didn't work. Switching up the paradigm, he's looking to provide a warm, supportive atmosphere to help improve concept of self and to gain insight about problems. So it's a very affirming situation. Automatically, you come in with a lack of judgment of a negative type. The therapist constructs, which are key, are these. Active listening. Active listening matters. It sounds like a cliche. How does that make you feel? How does that make you feel? How does that make you feel? Therapists don't do that. But they do ask you how that makes you feel. You know why? Because they don't know. Unless they ask you, they have no idea. Some people will be talking to me, man, I got so angry. I was so angry I couldn't see straight. You know what I mean? And all of us in conversation go, yeah, I hear you. I know, man. Wow, sure. But I don't know what that means. And neither does anybody else. That's just something you do in social conversation. Yeah, I hear you. I would say, how angry did it make you? In what ways did you exhibit angry? For some people, angry is this. Other people, they're throwing shit, knocking holes in walls. There's a big difference. And unless I ask you, I will have no idea. And that is the key. I need to understand what the world is like from your perspective as the client or the patient. Not my judgments about that. I need to get into your phenomenological reality. So I need to ask you questions that might seem innocuous on the surface, but are designed to get at some hidden emotional content that people just don't share, and when they do share it, other people just kind of blow off without really understanding it. That phenomenological reality is important. Some people ask me, how do you know somebody's telling you the truth in therapy? And I say, quite honestly, I don't. I don't know if anybody's telling me the truth. All I know is whether I believe they're telling me what they believe to be the truth. And what they believe to be the truth is their reality. And that's what I have to work with. Objective reality is a very interesting concept. When you get a couple who comes into therapy, you got one who goes, man, she's such a bitch. She's always nagging on me. She's always giving me all these problems and I can't hardly stand it no more. And blah, 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 blah. Well, that other person in there going, yeah, I am. I'm a total bitch. I'm always giving them problems and stuff, right? When you switch it over to the other side, guess what happens? You're like, he's an asshole. He's all the time trying to control me and dominate me. And you got two people who have two very different realities. So what matters is not what's the truth. Well, you're half an asshole and you're half a bitch, and together y'all make a mess of things, right? That ain't the objective here. The objective is to understand how two people who were so much in love and attracted to one another eventually came to hate one another. How did that happen? In the reality of the world, you wouldn't predict that. If everybody loves everybody on the front end, you would think that would predict good things on the back end. What happens is people interpret reality for themselves, and that becomes their world, their reality, their truth, and that's important. And I won't know any of that unless I actually ask questions in a very, very, systematic way designed to elicit information to help me better understand what another person's experiencing, not whether I have some kind of truthometer or I have some kind of standard that you should adhere to, because that's just not true. We don't have advice giving as a part of professional therapy. We might suggest techniques and strategies you could apply for yourself, but I'm not going to tell you what you ought to do with yourself. Genuineness. You need to be genuine. You need to come there to that therapeutic relationship as a therapist being a totally genuine human being. And that is a hard thing to do for some people. You have to learn how to train yourself. When you spend 1 hour there, like, man, you got a pretty easy job. All you do is listen to people talk all day, right? Try to listen to people talk all day where you focus intensely on... You ever focused intensely on another person's conversation for 50 minutes straight? It's hard. Where you're not thinking already what you're going to say next. Where you're actually listening to everything they say. You're actually trying to understand everything they say. And you're putting that in a paradigm of your own training, making hypotheses and trying to conjecture in what ways you might suggest some kinds of techniques or strategies to help them help themselves. That takes emotional energy. And it takes attention span that most humans don't have, right? Most humans, we peak out about 15 minutes. So to focus on somebody, you have to train yourself to do it. You have to leave your problems at the door, right? And believe me, you got problems. Ain't no therapist that don't have any problems, right? But that's not my job. My job is not to be problem-free and show how people can live a problem-free life. That's unrealistic. My job is to leave my stuff here and help you focus on you by being a tool with which you examine your own life. And I have to be real about that. And people can tell when you're not being real. They can tell when you're not being sincere. Unconditional positive regard. That goes back to when we talked about it before. Providing a space where you automatically assume the other person is valuable. You want to see people devalue human beings, get on Twitter, or get on Facebook. It doesn't take long before you see people talking shit about everybody and how they ain't worth this and they ain't good enough for that. And they've got all kind of judgments. As a therapist, you don't do that. You don't do that. You provide an unconditional positive regard, which says basically this. As a human being meeting a human being, I assume you have inherent value as a human being. You may have made bad behavioral choices, which I'm going to reserve judgment on, because my goal is not to judge you. My goal is to help you. And some people say, well, man, there's certain people I just couldn't work with. I couldn't work with an abuser of children, or I couldn't work with a rapist, and I couldn't work. Nobody thinks those are good things. You're not condoning behavior by engaging in unconditional positive regard. The goal here is to what? Have people not do that anymore, right? And if they walk in the door and say, well, yeah, I did that, and you go, man, you're a piece of shit. What's your odds that you're going to help them not do that anymore? Pretty low. So you would say, well, I don't condone that behavior. In fact, I find the behavior abhorrent. That would be inside me and my value judgment. But my value judgment is not to be laid upon people who come in for help. It's to be reserved for me in my personal world while I help somebody else realize that they have within them the capacity to be a good and effective human being and to figure out how to activate those positive choices that prevent them from making a mess of their own lives or a mess of other people's lives. Because that is the goal. it's not to be a judge. We have a criminal justice system with judges and juries. That's their role. I'm not saying it's not an important role. I'm just saying as a therapist, that's not your job. You need to know what your biases are and your values are, and you need to be able to, and if you can't work with somebody because what they're dealing with hits home too close to you, you need to be able to understand that and refer them to somebody else who can work with them. Being non-directive, that's a client-centered approach. The psychodynamic approach is pretty directive. I say you're going this way because you got resistance to going that way. I say we ought to go that way. Behaviorism, pretty directive. You tell me the behaviors, I'll tell you how to analyze the contingencies, how to manipulate them, and you'll do those things. But in client-centered therapy, you're the one coming for help. You tell me what you want to do. You tell me where you want to go. One of those kind of cliche questions is, if you could wave a magic wand, and you can do this for yourself, if you could wave a magic wand in your life right now and make all things perfect for you, what would life be like? What would life be like if everything for you within the realm of reality was perfect? And most people are like, God, I don't know. I never even thought about what life would be like if it was good. I just am so busy dealing with stuff I think's bad. I've never really thought about what it would be like if I overcame the stuff that was bad and plotted a new course for myself and took responsibility and control back. And empathy. Empathy seems to be the biggest factor, maybe up to 40% of whether therapy is effective or not, is whether the person coming in for therapy believes that their therapist is actually empathetic with them, trying to understand who they are, not judging them, not just dismissing them, but trying to really understand what's going on in their lives. And that's a hard thing to do because, again, we all have our own issues with attention span, biases, values, et cetera, to be able to provide genuine empathy. I can do it. People are like, man, aren't you just paying for friendship? No. Believe me, you can't be friends with your clients. You can't go hang out. All those movies where you see people fall in love with their therapists, those therapists would be fired and prosecuted. You can't do that. You can't get in relationships with your therapist. It's unethical and illegal. Right? You can't do it. Do people ever do it? Yes, that's how we got those ethical codes to begin with. Because it's damaging to the person who comes in and it's totally inappropriate. So all that fantasy stuff aside, you gotta look at this and go, well, it's not a friendship that I'm buying. It's a service I am engaging to help me understand myself better. And to do that, I need to have somebody who's trained to help me work through my issues. Because that will help me like a coach helps an athlete. Not because they're gonna work magic, not because they're gonna make you better, because they won't. But they'll provide a space in which you can help yourself become more effective at living the life you'd like to live, and empathy is key to that. So can I really empathize with anybody that walks in the door? Absolutely. I have a total philosophy that every human being is valuable, period. And so my time with them is valuable, even if it's once. I have conversations with students every semester, sometimes for an hour or 2 hours when they're in distress, and I help them find resources that might help them. And then a year goes by, I may not even remember that conversation. Does that make it any less genuine than the 2 hours I spent with them where I was focused on nothing but them? No. My memory limitations aside, what I'm saying is anybody who wants to help other people can be trained to do so in a variety of professions. In fact, any healthcare profession, people should have some kind of background in mental health, at least a little bit of training, because guess what you're going to encounter? In the health professional world, issues, and they matter.